Welcome back to this lecture series on object-oriented programming. In this video today, we're going to talk about the fundamental question of what a program is. What even is a program? What is software? What is an algorithm? And the answer to this question really depends on a bunch of other questions, or your answers to a bunch of other questions. The first question really is the question of what paradigm, what programming paradigm you are talking about. So depending on your, let's say, point of analysis, depending on your point of departure, depending on from where you stand, what constitutes a program looks kind of different. And what is a paradigm? I mean, a paradigm is this word, never mind the history, it was coined by Thomas Kuhn, I think, but it means like when scientists shift from a particular view of the world to a fundamentally different view that is irreconcilable with the old version of the world or the old view of the world. So paradigm means we had this old idea of the world before, and now we have this new idea of the world. And maybe you can think about the Earth-centric view of the world, or the cosmos, or the sun-centric view of the, maybe not the cosmos, but our solar system, right? And so there are a bunch of programming paradigms, whereas object-oriented programming is usually called a paradigm, right? It's the object-oriented paradigm of programming. So that is really the first question. But now I realize, actually, I was talking about a slide that's not the first slide. So first slide, we'll get to paradigms, right? But the first slide is this, and it says basically this: irrespectively of what paradigm you choose to view programming from, you can still view it in this way. You can say, okay, I have some kind of computing device. I have a machine, right? Think back, way back. I mean, in this lecture series, we're not going to deal with the history of programming, but there are all these I think it's called looms, right? Like these sewing machines, for example, that they are instrumental to the development of programming and to the development of computers. You have this machine that produces some kind of input from some kind of produces some kind of output from some kind of input. It consumes some kind of input and it produces some kind of output. Right? And if we think about it in a trivial sense, I mean, I don't know what these are called, but you know these small sort of machines that play like piano music when you crank the handle, you sort of rotate the handle and it goes do 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 do, and then there are all these small pins that hit like small knobs in a cylinder, and as the cylinder passes by, And these, I mean, knobs is entirely the wrong word. My English vocabulary is too poor. But there are all these things that are hit when this thing is rotating, and it makes music, right? And so this is, in a sense, a very physical form, a physical manifestation of the idea of programming. You have this basic computing machine where you crank the handle, and you put into it some kind of program. And in that case, the program is the cylinder, the dots on the cylinder, or the bumps on the cylinder that makes the sort of, the things that make sound, the things that vibrate, they make them move in order, they displace them in order to make sounds. This was a stupid analogy, dude. Sorry, so the point is basically this, right? A computing device is anything that can turn input into output, and software is something that you load up into your computing device in order to match output to input in some sense. And I say, in this slide, I say interaction also, right? Because it could be continuous input. It could be that, I mean, if you think about software like a word processing application like Word or Pages, when you think about an image editing application like Photoshop or maybe Instagram or whatever, I mean, these apps, right? You interact with them. You touch here, you touch here, you touch there, and things happen, right? You click here, you click here, you type here and whatnot, and things happen, right? So there's a continuous interaction. But the point is, the machine is this general purpose machine, right? It's the phone, or it's this thing that could make music, for which I have no name, right? Or, I mean, it could be a computer, right? Or in a car, maybe there's a computer. There's an embedded computer inside of the car. And it doesn't look like our PCs or our Macs or our phones, but it's still a computer and it's programmable, right? It's a general purpose computing device. It's a general purpose computer because you can run it with different software. You can load it up with the different software. And then as you provide input to that program, you get particular output, right? And this is sort of the whole game. No matter how you sort of slice the pie, this is in essence what you end up with. And then there are two in pink here. There's the word language, and then syntax and semantics, right? So whenever you're programming, you're programming in a particular language. Now usually, and I mean in this lecture series, we'll talk about the language C# mostly, and that language is expressed in terms of words, these particular keywords. You're expressing it using text. Like you open up a text editor and you write text, and that's how you express yourself in this language called C#, right? But it could be any other language such as Python or whatever. But in these physical machines, you might supply physical things rather than textual representations, right? The language might be physical rather than just textual, right? But in some sense, it's always symbolical, right? You express a certain set of symbols or a certain string of symbols, a long series of symbols, and that symbol, that string of symbols constitutes your program. And that's what you run, put inside of the machine. Now, I guess, I mean, maybe this thing that where you crank the handle and you make music, that shouldn't perhaps be called a general purpose computing device, because it's not Turing complete. And I don't want to talk about Turing completeness, but that's this whole idea of whether you can compute anything that's effectively computable. But yeah, so I mean, there's a finite set of programs that you could actually express on such a device. But still, I mean, the analogy, this is what I was getting at. You should think about this physically, right? You have this machine and you load up this machine with this program expressed in the language that the machine supports, and then you interact with the machine, and then the machine spits out some particular output, right? And that's sort of the whole game, no matter how you slice it. Okay, I think let's leave that, right? And you can see here, I wrote program/software/algorithm. Maybe you could argue that there are some slight nuances, but it's basically the same thing, right? When you write an algorithm, you solve a problem, right? And you solve that problem in a programming language. So an algorithm means something like a sequence of instructions that a computer can understand in order to solve a problem, right? Expressed in order to solve a problem. But that's basically the same notion as a program, and it's basically the same thing as software. So if you think about software and hardware, for example, the computing device, that's the hardware, that's the hard physical things. And then the software, the program, that's the soft stuff. That's how we express something in a particular language. But again, I mean, in theory and back in the days, software could be physical as well, right? But it's still a program. Okay, I've hammered in this point enough. Let's leave this, right? So now we are to the question of paradigms, right? What a program is depends on your a paradigm, depends on what paradigm you're talking about programs from, right? And I explained a bit about this, so we won't go into this in detail. Now, there are more paradigms than what I've put up here on the screen. So if you're interested in this, Wikipedia has an interesting page on programming paradigms, for example. So by the way, I mean, generally, I'll put links to things that we talk about and sometimes references to things that we talk about in the show notes. So do always check the show notes if you're interested in reading more about some of this stuff. So two paradigms, right? Two paradigms that we have are the imperative paradigm and the declarative paradigm, right? So imperative, I don't actually know what the literal translation of imperative means, but in a programming paradigm sense of the word, it means first do this, then do this, then do this, then do this, then do this, and so forth and so forth and so forth, right? And it could be varyingly structured. It could be do this, then do this, then do this, then go back to this place and do this, or run this method and do this and whatnot, right? But the point is, we view programs as a sequence of instructions, right? We say, okay, what is a program? A program is a sequence of instructions that we give to the computer in order to execute from the top and down to the bottom where the program is finished, right? And it could be infinite, of course, right? But you start from the top and then you go down. Line by line by line, you go down and down and down. First do this, then do this, then do this, then do this, then do this, right? And if you think about like coffee making, right? Something like, so I use one of these press things to make coffee, right? But when we make coffee. So I mean, step one would be maybe to put a pan on the stove, put water in the pan, right? And it's not a pan, whatever, you get the point. You put water in the pan, you put the pan on the stove, you turn on the stove in order to boil up the water, you take out the coffee thing, you put the coffee in the coffee thing, you pour the boiling water into the coffee thing, you wait for 5 minutes, and then you push down the thing in order to make the coffee go through the world. Anyways, the point is, right, you have this sequence of instructions. First you do this, then you do this, then you do this, and then you do this. And it could, of course, be, it could be variable, it could be parameterized, and so forth. We'll get to this in a moment, right? But this, you should contrast to this idea of the declarative paradigm, where in the declarative paradigm, you don't say, first do this, then do this, then do this. You say, what is? You say, my program is the result of something like this, right? So you can see how there are these two subsets in these bigger sets, right? We have the imperative paradigm, the declarative paradigm. And in the imperative paradigm, I've lifted up these notions of the procedural paradigm and the object-oriented paradigm. And in the declarative, I've highlighted the functional paradigm and the logic paradigm, right? So if you think about the functional paradigm, we essentially say that programs are functions. It could be a function that never terminates, but it's a function, right? So it's a function that never reaches a result. So a program is the result of computing the result of that function. And this sounds a bit strange, but actually as you get into functional programming, it's a very intuitive way of thinking about it. So if you don't think about, we'll talk about mutability and immutability and side effects and these things. So I understand if you haven't heard about those terms, this might not at first sight make a lot of sense, but think about it this way. If you don't think about side effects, if you don't think about how a program might actually change something in the real world, but if you only think about how a program might compute something, right? As you have an algorithm that computes something from some input, you want to compute some output. The functional paradigm is very, very intuitive, right? Because, I mean, most of us have studied some amount of math and you've done functions and functions are basically just this mapping from input values to output values. You have the input domain and then you have the codomain, right? Values from the input domain are matched to the image, which is the subset of the codomain. So you map to values. So one is mapped to two, or two is mapped to four, and three is mapped to six. Let's say if we're expressing a doubling function, a function that doubles every number, right? And in that sense, I mean, if you have that kind of problem, it makes a lot of sense to think about a program as a function, right? A program is a function that says, whatever the input was, let me return that input times two, right? That's the doubling function. If that's your whole program, then that's fine, right? But in the taking that same thing and doing that in the imperative world, then it's like, okay, so this is a trivial example because you would have expressions and you would have the multiplication operator in almost any imperative language. But if it was more complex, it would be like you move this thing here, you move this thing here, and you move this thing here in order to compute the fact that the result of this, of running this program, would be four or six or eight or whatever. So yeah, I mean, this is sort of the fundamental divide. And there are more paradigms, and logic programming, for example, is different from functional programming. But this is a good starting point, right? I mean, if you understand that there's the declarative paradigm and that there's the imperative paradigm, and that when we're talking about object-oriented programming, we're in the imperative paradigm, that's a very good start, right? So let's go back to the imperative, right? In the imperative, so by the way, I also have a bunch of videos on functional programming. I would highly recommend that you dive into functional programming because it seems, I mean, I'm one of these people who argue that it seems self-evident that we're moving towards the world of functional programming, whether that is through hybrid languages, hybridizing languages, as I put here in the asterisk, right? Many languages actually mix paradigms. So C# and Java, for example, are two prime examples of languages that are just, you know, they've just exploded with ideas from every paradigm here and there. I mean, that's an overstatement. What I mean is mostly from the object-oriented and from the functional paradigm. But there are so many ideas that are not strictly object-oriented that are now in these languages, C# and Java. So yeah, it seems eventually most of us will have to get a hold of functional programming as well, and then there's some very, very interesting fruit to be had. But, okay, sorry, this is a lecture series on object-oriented programming, not functional programming. But again, I have some videos on functional programming. So let's go back to the imperative paradigm. So in the imperative paradigm, we have the procedural paradigm and we have the object-oriented paradigm. And again, we're not going to talk about the history, but I mean, procedural is what preceded the notion of object orientation. And procedural, some of you have done, right? It's like, instead of just having imperative statements where it's like, do this, do this, do this, do this, do this, do this, all the way from the top down to the end, right? You impose some more structure and you say, actually, you can have procedures. You can have these things called methods. I can have this method called add. I can have this method called write to screen. I can have this method called read from file, or take input from user, and whatnot, right? And you can call these methods, you can invoke these methods in order to delegate down, in order to not have to repeat yourself, in order to avoid having to do these go-to statements where you jumped from different lines of the program, which was what preceded this notion of procedures. And there's probably modules as well in this paradigm of procedural programming. But the basic point to get is basically that the procedural paradigm introduces this notion of procedures, of methods, right? I don't want to say functions, right? Because functions, we tend to nowadays reserve for the functional paradigm, because we tend to imply that functions don't have side effects. And in a few slides, you'll see what I mean with the word side effects. But The procedural paradigm introduces this notion of procedure. You bunch up this bunch of code and you say, actually, this procedure, I will call something. I will name it something. And whenever I need to do this particular thing, I will call this procedure, and this procedure will do that thing for me instead of me having to repeat it all the time. Okay, and then comes the object-oriented programming paradigm. Sorry, the object-oriented paradigm. And here, the basic idea is just this. It's that actually, if you encapsulate state inside of these procedures, this thing is called a closure. And we're not going to talk about closures, but if you've heard about closures or if you want to look into that more, I don't mean the language closure. There's also a language called closure, but I mean this idea called a closure. I highly recommend you to look into that, because there's this famous quote that said something like, an object is just a poor man's closure, right? So these are very much the same idea. But you bundle up state inside of a procedure so that you can have multiple procedures that have different states. And this will make sense as we dive into it further on. I think then in the next lecture, we'll talk about objects and encapsulation. But you encapsulate state inside of an object, and then you call methods on that object, right? So there are a bunch of methods that are associated with some particular state. And objects in this world of object orientation, they are, I mean, they could be anything, but it could be a cat, it could be a person, it could be a bank account, it could be a transaction, it could be a text box, like it could be a screen resolution, it could be like anything, right? Anything that's a noun is a candidate for an object. And actually, I mean, anything that's a verb is also a candidate for an object, because you can turn that into, I mean, language-wise, you can turn that into a noun as well. Like if you have a something that, if you have a function that says double, for example, right, multiply by 2, then you can always turn that into a noun by saying that this is a doubler, and then suddenly it's a noun, right? And then it's an object. So this is how, I mean, you can really translate code from the functional paradigm into the object oriented paradigm, and so back and forth. And people do this. People do name what are then called classes, right? We'll get into that, but do have objects that represent verbs rather than nouns, because it's a very important part of programming. But okay, we're getting ahead of ourselves, right? Instead of letting the fundamental building block be procedures, you let the fundamental building block be objects that you can send messages to, that you can communicate with back and forth. You can say, okay, hey, you cat, do this. Or rather, let me take something more better or something more appropriate. Let's say, hey, you, transaction A, execute yourself, right? Or here's a record, write this record to the database. Or here's an image, like let's think about Instagram, right? Here's an image, post this image, right? Or something like this. But this is maybe not as representative of how people would actually do it. Maybe it would be something more simple. Like let's say you have an image on Instagram, and then you would say, image, what's your size? How wide are you? How high are you? And width and height in pixels. What's your resolution? What's the color depth of this image? And so forth, right? You ask objects questions and you tell them to do things. And this is sort of the mental model of the object-oriented paradigm. Okay, let's keep going forward, right? One of the basic points is that languages mix paradigms, right? As we've talked about. Okay, so the next thing we need to understand, maybe I should pause and say this. What we're doing now is that we're talking about different things that you need to understand in order to understand what a programming language is, right? All of these facets matter when you have a given programming language, right? A given programming language is always in a paradigm. There's no sort of paradigm-free language. And so the next question we want to ask ourselves is this notion of compilation versus interpretation. Is this language usually compiled or is it interpreted, right? And this is also something that's like, it's always true, right? Either it's compiled or it's interpreted when we're talking about programming languages in computers, of course. So compilation is basically, let's start with compilation, right? The basic idea is this. The machine, the actual computer, understands binary, right? Ones and zeros. And people are not good at writing ones and zeros when we are trying to express complex concepts, right? Imagine if you had to use ones and zeros in order to build applications such as Photoshop or Adobe Premiere or a word processor or Instagram or whatnot, right? I mean, this is crazy difficult. So there are all these layers and layers and layers on top of this machine code. And I don't want to talk about all these layers. And again, like we're not going to get into the technical details. The point is there are all these layers.
operators.
And eventually everything has to boil down to ones and zeros, right? And these ones and zeros are CPU specific. It depends on your processor. So these ones and zeros need to be expressed in the language that your processor understands, right? So there are all these layers of abstraction between this low level of ones and zeros and the high level of programming languages that we actually use, such as, for example, C sharp. Sorry, I said we actually use, of course some people use low level languages, but when we're talking about languages such as C sharp or Java or Python or Ruby or Haskell, or I mean, now we're switching paradigms, right? Or JavaScript, or, you know, any of these languages, these are high level languages that eventually have to boil down to machine code. And machine code are these ones and zeros. But we write in something that's much more high level. And again, every language has syntax and it has semantics. Syntax is, what does this language actually look like? What is a valid sentence in this language? So if I say, I am Christopher, right? This is a valid sentence in English, syntactically. But it is also a semantically meaningful sentence. So semantics is concerned with the idea of meaning. So it means something useful in that language because it's stating that I, this individual, I am this identifier. I'm identifying myself as this identifier, as this name, right? So it's semantically meaningful. But let's take something nonsensical, right? Like, well, I mean, that would makes sense as well. I was going to say that, like, Christopher is green. Of course, Christopher could be green. Yeah, let me think on that for a moment. But the point that I want to make is this. Things can be syntactically valid, yet semantically meaningless. You can express a valid program, syntactically valid, right? It compiles. It's a program that is valid given the language. It's a valid program in the language, but maybe it's a pointless program. Doesn't do any of the things that you actually want the program to do. So it has the wrong semantics. It does the wrong thing. Okay, this is syntax and semantics. Do always feel free to pause and Google and look up, for example, Wikipedia pages for the concepts that I'm talking about, because almost all the concepts that we're talking about in this lecture series have Wikipedia pages. Like separate Wikipedia pages. Anyways, so a compiler or an interpreter is what takes this high-level source language and turns it into this low-level machine code. High-level source language down to this low-level machine code. That's a compiler or an interpreter. Now, a compiler is something that takes the program, builds an executable, gives you that executable, and lets you run that executable, and that executable is expressed in terms of machine code. And this is an oversimplification, right? But roughly, it's this process. So when you have an .exe file on Windows, and it's not strictly true, right? But roughly, right? Then that is expressed in terms of machine code. And then as you run that, you can now execute the machine code. But in order to get that executable file, you need to compile your source code. You need to compile your file that you've written or the files that you've written in a programming language. You need to run that through a compiler in order to get this executable file. And generally, right, this notion of compilation is not just for machine language. It's from source language to target language, right? And actually, I think maybe I have this on the next slide, right? Yeah, so you can have a high-level language and you can have a low-level language. So on the left, we have a high-level language. On the right, we have a low-level language. You compile from a high-level language down to a low-level language. And this is why I say it's a process, right? Because now we're just showing the whole process from source code down to machine code. And source code is I mean, the word source code just means when we are writing in a programming language, we write source code. That's what we do. We write source code. But there could be multiple steps involved in actual compilers where you compile not from the highest level language down to the lowest level language immediately, but you go through a number of intermediate steps, as we'll see. But this holds true irrespective of whether you're doing C#, Java, Ruby, Python, Haskell, F#, and so forth and so forth, like all these languages. So what's this deal about an interpreter, right? So an interpreter is a similar idea, but it says that actually there's a process that's running, that's reading the program that you wrote in the source language, and it's compiling it to the target language on the fly. It's reading a chunk and then translating that to machine code or something along those lines. So it's basically that you have a separate process that continuously consumes your input program and spits out machine code that it executes, right? So it's sort of like your programming is running inside of another program. So compilation, you can think of as you take some input source code, you run it through the compiler, and you get some output source code or target code. You run it through the compiler, and you get some other code out. Whereas an interpreter, you can think of as you run the interpreter, and the interpreter reads your code and then executes the target language as well, right? It doesn't just spit out the target language, it executes the target language. And so that could be executing machine code, for example. Okay, so hopefully that makes a bit of sense. Okay, so let's keep going. I'm by no means an expert on compilation, nor .NET for that matter, which is this ecosystem that exists around languages such as C#, right? So Microsoft is sort of the author of the language C#, and then there's this ecosystem called .NET that brings together a bunch of different languages, which includes C# and F#, and back in the days, Visual Basic and whatnot. So I'm by no means an expert on this, but I just want to show you this slide in order to emphasize how, let's say, more complex compilation could actually be in the real world for a bunch of different reasons, such as compatibility between different processors and compatibility between different languages. So for these reasons, people have introduced additional layers of abstraction. And this notion of a layer of abstraction is hopefully something that we'll return to a lot during this lecture series, because it's something that we think about a lot as programmers. Whenever you have a problem and then you realize, actually, there's some commonality between this specific problem here and this other specific problem here, then perhaps I need an abstraction. I need to abstract the problem on the left and I need to abstract the problem on the right in order to find a solution for both problems. And then I can maybe add small specializations to either of them, right? In order to solve those particular problems, right? So this is the notion of abstraction. We say, actually, okay, if you look at the abstraction, if I abstract this problem, these two problems that were previously different now start to look the same. Right? And this is really the thing that we're doing as programmers. We look at problems and we say, actually, there's some commonality between all these things. And if I find that commonality, if I abstract out the details, I can build a program around the commonality. So if I was a better person, I would have had a slide here that was called abstraction, and then we would have talked about abstraction. But hopefully you now feel that we've talked about abstraction. Let's now actually talk about what's on the slide, which is compilation in .NET, right? So there are all these different languages in the .NET ecosystem. Right? One is F#, one is C#. So F#, by the way, is a functional language in the .NET ecosystem. And C# is the imperative language that we're using in this lecture series. And then it could be a bunch of other stuff, right? So you run your source files expressed in these languages, you run them through specific compilers. So you run your C# code through a C# compiler. And that produces some intermediate language, right? A common intermediate language that's shared across every language in this .NET ecosystem, right? And this is back to this notion of abstraction. They say, okay, why should we write a compiler for every language from our target language up here down to the machine code? Couldn't we just write down to our own intermediate language that we control and that we can keep consistent across processing architectures? Because then you would just have the task of compiling from this common intermediate language down to machine code for every platform, such as, let's say, Mac or Windows. You could have the same common intermediate language in both of these cases, but then you just vary the translation to machine code, the compilation process to machine code. And hopefully here you can see how they've found the abstraction, right? Instead of having a many-to-many problem, you have a many-to-one problem, and then you have a one-to-many problem. Because here, up here, you have many source languages, and down here where it says machine code, you have many target languages, right? But instead of connecting everything to everything, you instead just connect all the source languages to a single shared intermediate language. And then that intermediate language can be compiled down for a number of different processing architectures. So it's a very, very good idea, right? And it's very common and it's by no means specific to .NET. And maybe even if the diagram doesn't look the same, it's something along those lines for Java as well. And I presume for other languages as well. All right, let's leave the realm of compilation and interpretation. If you want to drink a coffee now, take a break. Okay, now we're back. So let's talk about data types as sets. This is a very important, it's a very important idea to get an intuition about. If you've done some programming, you've come across types. We have these things, we can have variables, right? And then you store a value inside a variable. You say, I have a number, X, and this X happens to be 5. Right? And then we say that the data type of X in that case is, for example, an integer. So an integer is a whole number including 0 and including negative numbers, right? That's a set of all integers. So what type theorists, because this is called type theory, what type theorists have figured out is that there's a close analogy between data types and between sets, mathematical sets. So if you're not familiar with the notion of sets, a set is I'm not going to give you formal definitions here because I'm not a mathematician and I'm not a type theorist, but a mathematical set is in some sense just a bunch of objects. And this bunch, this collection, could be empty. So it's either an empty or it's a non-empty collection of things. And this collection of things could contain collections of other things, right? But it could be anything. You could say, I have the set S, and this set S contains every cat in the world, like every literal cat. Or you could say I have a set that contains every natural number, right? Which is all the numbers starting from 1, and then 2, and then 3, and then 4, and then 5, and so forth into infinity, right? So it's an infinite set, right? The set of cats is probably not infinite. It's not infinite if you take it at any moment of time, because there's a finite, albeit like a very large number of cats in the world, but there is a finite number of cats in the world. The set of all natural numbers is, of course, an infinite set, because you could just keep going and add one. Alternatively, we could think about, if I use some of the examples that are here on the slide, you can think about this type called a Boolean. So a Boolean is something that's either true or it's false. So the set of Booleans contains just two elements. If you have a Boolean, that means it's either true or it's either false. Here's the analogy, right? I think you're starting to see this, right? When we say a data type, we can essentially just say set. Because when you say X is a variable, and in this variable I hold some value of type integer, well, that means that you should think about that. Your mental model should be, there's a set, and that set contains, for example, let's say integers, right? If I say that I have a variable and its type is integer, then that means that the set of integers represent every possible valid value that my variable could have. And it seems like this is sort of a silly thing to say, because it's sort of self-evident or whatnot, right? But here's the kicker, right? At least in my mind. Maybe you've heard about this notion of null, right? N-U-L-L, right? Null, or nil in some languages. In Ruby, it's called nil. And this is a representation of the absence of a value. So in some languages, including C#, some types can not just be values from their set, let's say strings, for example. Or I think this goes for character, maybe. Okay, let's say string. So string is a text, right? A character is just a single character, a single letter. But a string is a set of characters, right? Or a sequence of characters, right? So the word hello, for example, is a string. So a string in C# can be null. So that means whenever you say I have an X, and this X is of type string, I have a thing, and this thing is of type string, this thing contains some text, you are not actually guaranteed that it contains text, because it could also contain null. It could also contain the absence of a value. So that means you have to think about nullable. And here I think it's helpful to think about sets, because then you can think about it this way. You can say, okay, is my data type represented by the set of strings or not? Because if it's nullable, like if it can be null, that means it's actually the union, it's both the set of strings, of all possible strings, but it's also this set of this unary set that only contains a single element, which is null, right? The null set. So another way that I think sets are useful when reasoning about types, when thinking about your system, is to think about this thing. I'm trying to remember who said that, but I think maybe it's Richard Feldman, who said that you should make impossible states impossible. Right? So what that means is that because we have types in our systems, we should make sure that our types are constructed such that our systems can never find themselves in a state that's nonsensical. So if you have a string, for example, and it's very critical, if you have a text, right, and that text needs to be displayed somewhere, and it's very critical that that text is not empty. And here I'm not referring to null, as in it doesn't have a value. You could also have the empty string, right, which is the string that's just nothing. It's just empty. It's blank. And it's not even space. It's just blank, right? If it's important to you in your domain that you don't have end up with a blank string, then you should invent a new data type. You should construct a new set, and you say, this is my set of allowed values given my domain. I have a type that's called non-empty string, for example, and it guarantees you that this string is never just blank, right? Maybe this is a silly example. A better example, I guess, would be this, a phone number, right? You could let phone numbers be represented by text. But that's actually a very bad way of representing phone numbers, right? Because the set of all strings, think about the set of all possible strings. What are valid strings? Hello is a valid string. World is a valid string. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is a valid string. I mean, every phone number is a valid string, yes, right? But there are so many phone numbers that are not valid strings. So like this, if I'm drawing this circle here, right? This is the set of all possible strings. But there's a subset in here that's just tiny, and that's the set of all strings that are also phone numbers, right? Every phone number is a string, right? But there are so many strings that are not phone numbers, right? And yes, of course, you could think about all of this that I'm saying just thinking about data types, but it helps to think about it in terms of sets, because then you can use these set theory concepts such as union, such as intersection, and so forth, right? And subset, right? So you can say, okay, actually, my type is a subset of this other type, or maybe rather what we said with the phone number example. I have this, I'm using this type, but actually the thing that I'm actually talking about is a subset of that type. So I should invent a new type that represents this subset. So this is this analogy between types and sets. You can have things, and these things can be of types. And whenever you have a type, you can represent that type using a set, right? You can say, this is the set of all integers, this is the set of all characters, the set of all booleans, the set of all cats, or whatever, right? I mean, you invent your sets, but it's helpful to think about types as sets. Okay, let's move on. Another more concrete point is, let me put it this way. Now we are talking about the object-oriented paradigm, right? I mean, types apply to all paradigms, right? Types are heavily used in functional programming as well. I mean, in any statically typed language, you are making heavy use of types, and I'll get to what static typing is. But even in what is called dynamically typed languages, even then you should think about sets and types in order to reason about your programs. But here's what I want to say. Now we're talking about the object-oriented paradigm. Yes. In theory, right? In rough theory, the idea of the object-oriented programming paradigm is that everything is an object. The program is a collection of objects that communicate with other objects. That's the analogy, that's the idea, right? Unfortunately, that's not true practically in many languages. Now, you can have more or less of this, and I'll use the word pure in a different sense, but some authors use the word purity to describe how purely object-oriented a language is, right? So I'll try to say purely object-oriented if I mean it in that sense, but otherwise purity is often referred to the purity of functions. But how purely object-oriented the programming language is depends, right? Okay. So the next thing we need to understand is the difference between value types and between reference types, right? Maybe we should draw for this one, right? So the difference between value types and reference types is something like this. Like, if you say, for example, that I have an x, and I say that x is equal to 5. Maybe I do this, right? If I say y is also equal to 5. This is a good example. So I have x is equal to 5, I have y is equal to 5. We're thinking now in a procedural paradigm. So it's like I'm executing from the top down. We're starting from the top. We say first, okay, x, and remember, right, we're in the procedural paradigm, this equals operator is the assignment operator. So we're saying in x, I put the value 5. X now contains, x is a box, right? X is this box. And inside this box, I put the value 5, right? So whenever I'm talking about this box now, it contains 5. So x now contains 5 and y now contains 5, right? Now the question is, does x equal y, right? So equal equals here, let me take a different pen, right? So this equal equals, that's a different operator. This operator says, does x equal, is it the same thing, right? It's a question. Is x the same thing as y? That's the question, right? If we're talking about value types and you say x is equal to 5 and y is equal to 5, then x and y would be the same. But if we're talking about reference types, it's not obvious that they would be the same. Now, it depends, right? But if I express it differently, right? Now we're using some imaginary syntax, right? We're not using sort of any actual syntax. But if I say, for example, that x is equal to, let's say, a new, so new is a keyword that you'll see often used in object-oriented programming. I'm just using it here like loosely, just to emphasize that we're building something, we're constructing. We're constructing a new, let's say, cat called Snuffles. If x is a cat called Snuffles, and then I'll say y is a new cat also called Snuffles, does then x equal y? Because structurally, right, they're the same thing. They are both cats, and they are both named Snuffles. So from the outside, as we just look at this, it looks as if, I mean, for all intents and purposes, they're the same. But if we're talking about reference types, since we are using the keyword new, we are saying, this is not just an existing cat, I wanna construct a new cat, right? Then if we construct two new cats, then they can't possibly be the same. Because in memory, right? I mean, I don't wanna talk about memory, right? But in computer memory, they would point to different locations. This is cat X and this is cat Y. They're not actually the same memory location. Whereas in the case of 5, for example, right? These would both probably point to the same memory location, where this represents 5, right? We're sort of reasoning fast and loose, right? But this is the difference between reference types and value types. It means when you have a reference type, then whenever you build two things that look the same, that doesn't guarantee you that they actually are the same. And if you think about that also makes intuitive sense, right? I mean, my name is Christopher, right? But there are other Christophers around the world and we're not the same. So the point is, you can have something, you can have a non-exhaustive representation of something where two things that look completely the same actually aren't the same because they're not the same thing, right? They're not the same underlying, they're not representing the same underlying thing. Let's think about it this way. Let's draw here again. If you have a transaction, of €100 going from, let's say, from person A to person B. Maybe I should have drawn this with arrows, but whatever. You have this transaction of $100 from person A to person B. And then you have another transaction €100 from person A to person B. Is this the same transaction or not? Right? It totally depends, right? And it's the main specific question. And now the thing is, with reference types, you can make objects report that they are the same as a different object that has the same structure. If you want to, right? I mean, in this transaction example, you might, for example, want to say that, okay, if you have two transactions like this, they're the same transaction. They're referring to the same transaction. But maybe we have this like transaction ID where this is 1 and this is 2, right? Now they are structurally different. And then it would report that they're different because their structure differ, right? But it could also be that even if we don't have this 1 and 2, right? Even if they're structurally the same, if we don't implement an equals method, if we don't tell objects of this type how to compare themselves to each other in order to report equality, then these will be different if we're working with a type that's by reference, with a reference type, because they were both constructed. Actually, maybe I should say this. This was implicit. I didn't say this explicitly, right? Maybe I should do it this way. I want the cat page. Where's the cat page? Here's the cat page. So X is a new cat and Y is a new cat. The key point was essentially this new keyword. If I would say that Z is equal to X, then I'm not saying Z is a new cat. I'm saying Z is actually X and X is already a cat. So Z is the same cat as X, which means that if I say does X equals Z, then this will be true. This will be true. Whereas this thing before, if we say X equals Y, this will be false if these cats are reference types, right? Because X and Y are different cats. They've both been constructed, so they can't be the same. They're new things. But X and Z, they're the same, right? Because Z, we said, was equal to X. It's being assigned to the same thing as whatever X has. Right? So then if we think about it here in terms of memory, I mean, it's like Z now points to this same location in memory. Okay, so this is the notion of reference types and value types. And this is something, again, that depends on what language you are in. And as I put here in the asterisk, I mean, not all programming languages have both types. I mean, some languages are strictly value-based and some languages are strictly reference-based. But usually you have a mix between the two, so you need to keep your head straight and think about whether you're working with value types or reference types. So whenever you build a class, for example, whenever you make objects, your objects are reference types. But I mean, integers, booleans, characters, these are value types, right? It doesn't matter if you have one A or a different A, right? I mean, they're both in the set of characters, A is A, it doesn't matter. But in the set of all cats, where we only talk about the names of cats, if you have two cats called Snuffles, they're not necessarily the same cat. They could be the same cat, but it's not necessarily the same cat. So if you have a transaction or a cat or a person, or I mean, in object-oriented languages, basically an object, right? Then these are usually reference types. So in C#, everything that's an object derives from the object class. We'll get to both the notion of deriving and we'll get to the notion of classes, but soon, not yet, yes. But anything that's an object is basically then a reference type. Okay, so value types and reference types. We need to keep our heads straight in that. Okay, now I want to talk about this notion of static and dynamic typing. So much like a language, maybe I didn't say this, but when we talked about compilation and interpretation, I should have said that a language isn't necessarily compiled or interpreted. I mean, yes, of course, it's all just not binary. I mean, as you saw, the reality is much more complex than that. But it's not just the fact that a language is compiled or interpreted. It's that there exist compilers and interpreters for languages. But languages such as C# and Java tend to be considered compiled languages because they're mostly compiled. And for example, Ruby and Python are mostly considered interpreted languages because usually we use interpreters to run them. So there's that sort of approximation, or we're using words a bit loosely there, right? I mean, the community is. So the same thing goes for this notion of static and dynamic typing, in the sense that you could enforce. So the question here is, when do we enforce types? Do we enforce them at runtime, or do we enforce them at compile time? I mean, I should have put this the other way around, right? Because static is on the left and dynamic is on the right. So then compile time should be on the left and then runtime on the right, right? Because compile time corresponds to static and runtime corresponds to dynamic. Sorry about that. So static, compile time, dynamic, runtime. But the point is that an implementation is not necessarily either static or dynamic. And again, this is a spectrum, but a compiler or an interpreter is static or dynamic. But again, usually we talk about languages being statically typed or dynamically typed. So what does this mean, right? So the thing is, we've already talked about this. Like, you always have types. No matter how you do it, you always have types. Like, when you say that X is a variable and it contains 5, there are a number of things that you can do with numbers, right? And so if 5 is a whole number, right, is an integer, then there's a number of things that you can do with that. Now, if it's a decimal number, like it's 5.0, then there are other things that you could do with that. And those are maybe slight nuances. But of course, if you have a cat, or like if you have the string hello, like that's more obvious. If you have the number 1 and then you have the string hello, then there are of course fundamentally different things that you could do with those two types. So like if you have an expression where you're trying to add a bunch of stuff, like if you are trying to say 10 plus the string hello, what does that equal, right? Does that make sense or does that not make sense? I mean, maybe let's first do an expression that makes sense, right? Like if we say 10 plus 12, that makes sense because we would end up with 22. That's an expression, that's a valid statement that compiles. But here, when we say 10 plus hello, this doesn't type check in most languages. So in a language such as, in a language such as C#, it doesn't compile, because 10 is what? Is, for example, an integer, and hello is maybe a string. So you can't add a string to an integer, because what does that mean? Does that mean that you get 10 hello? Or does that mean that you just get 10, or just hello, or hello 10 times? I mean, there's a bunch of implementations. So the plus operator, now I'm just using functional programming syntax, you don't have to think about this, I'm just sort of trying to invite you to think about a number of different things at the same time. But I mean, the plus operator sort of has the syntax, or the type, that it takes an integer and it takes an integer and then it returns a new integer. But we have given it an integer and then we have given it a string and then expect to get, I don't know, an integer or a string or some kind of complex combination or whatnot, right? So the point is essentially this. This does not type check, is what we say about this, right? It does not type check. So if this doesn't type check, and again, I should say, in some languages it does type check, like JavaScript, for example, is extremely forgiving in allowing you to do interesting things when you combine things of different types. And this is, you could think about this notion of duck typing here. Do Google duck typing if you're interested in that. But the point is, if we assume that this doesn't type check, if we're in a language where it doesn't make sense to add a string to a number, to add 10 to hello, like there's no way to compute that. What would the result of that be? Then that doesn't type check. So when do we discover that? Do we discover that when we try to compile the program? Or do we discover that when we run the program? And this is an important distinction, right? Because this is what we refer to as compile time types or runtime types. It's static typing or dynamic typing. So if you're in a compiled language such as C#, and you're not making use of things such as the dynamic keyword, which lets you leave the realm of static typing in order to do something dynamically typed, right? Which, I mean, in like 99.999% of the cases, you shouldn't have to do, because you should just rethink your problem. But I mean, there are of course scenarios where that's useful. But if you're in a statically typed language such as C#, and this expression that we talked about doesn't type check, then when you try to compile the program, when you try to take your source file and convert that into a output file, a machine code file. And again, as we saw before, the process of doing that is of course a bit more complicated than just source code in, machine code out. But nevertheless, when you do that, when you try to compile it, it will not compile. You will not get an executable file at all because it doesn't type check. The compiler checks the types and says, actually here it doesn't line up. But if you're in a dynamically typed language, such as for example, Python or Ruby, you get the program. You can always run the program. You can just run it. And when we get to that point in the program, at the runtime, right, when the program is running, we will see if it works or if it doesn't work. And I won't get into arguments here about whether it makes sense or not to use static or dynamic typing. I mean, there's these different modes, right? There's static typing and there's dynamic typing. Okay, but these are two very important concepts, right? And C# is a statically typed language most of the time, right? Okay, so I think this is the last thing that I want to talk about in this particular lecture, which turned out to be extremely long. So hopefully, I mean, kudos to you if you're still sticking here, is this notion of purity. And I mentioned before that the word pure is sometimes used in relation to object-oriented programming to say things such as, wait, sorry, let's go back. Sorry, wait, let's go back to static and dynamic typing. There's one more thing we have to talk about. What we have to talk about is explicit versus implicit types. So, or rather, maybe I should say it as type inference versus explicit typing. So when you're in a language such as C#, you will see that we write things such as this. We say int x equals 5, for example. So we say x is a variable and its type is int, and it contains the value 5, right? Name of the variable, type of the variable, and its actual value. And this value 5, of course, has to have the same type, which is int, right? This is not C# syntax, but, and of course, this could be anything, right? It could be like a cat, and then let's call it just C, or let me call it lowercase cat. The variable called cat is of type cat, and it's equal to, right? Roughly, let's use roughly C# syntax, is equal to a new cat, and then I'll pass an argument in, let's say it's called meowie. So there's a variable called cat and its type is cat, and it's equal to the construction of a new thing of type cat, and then I'm passing the following arguments to that constructor in order to construct the cat. I understand that some of these words don't make sense, but we'll get to that in future lectures. But then we've constructed a cat, right? So the thing I want to talk about is that we now have explicit types, right? Here we're saying that the variable cat is of type cat. The variable x is of type int, right? So then we are explicitly stating types. But in some languages, you have what's known as type inference. And recently now we also have this in C#, where you could say, so in C# you would say var cat is equal to a new, da, 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 da. Let me just say, same thing as above, right? I mean the same thing here. So var cat is a new cat. Sorry, I should have written this like cat. This will result in the same thing. And what happens is that this var keyword does not mean that we leave the realm of static typing. This var keyword means that the compiler must infer, right? Infer what the type is of this particular variable cat. And it will come to the conclusion that it has to be type cat because we're constructing it directly as a new cat, right? And so oftentimes you can use this type inference in order to not have to specify types. Now, I would say, of course, please specify your types, right? When you're learning programming, just write your types out all the time. It's very much like, let's say, the language Haskell, for example, in the functional paradigm, has a very, very sophisticated type inference system. So you hardly, I mean, you can skip types very, very much. But actually, types help other programmers understand your program, right? Because we are not necessarily as good as the compiler in inferring types. So if things get very jumbled, right? If they get fairly complicated, then it's very, very helpful for us as humans to read the actual types, right? So that we can see what the actual type is. But this is the thing known as type inference and explicit typing. Okay. Back to this notion of purity. So in regards to this discussion of purity, I said before again that the word pure is sometimes used to describe purely object-oriented languages. But that's an entirely different meaning from what I mean here. What I mean here is that I don't mean whether something is very, very object-oriented or not. What we mean here is whether something has side effects or not, right? So I just want to spend like a few moments talking about this because to introduce you to this idea, because it's an idea that's growing increasingly important even in the community of object orientation. And this is, I guess, one of these things that might make people or convince people to leave the realm of object-oriented programming for pure functional programming, because it has immense benefits. So there are a bunch of words here, like pure versus impure, side effect free versus effectful, and immutable versus mutable. All of these deal with basically the same thing. And this basic thing is referential transparency, is whether something, when you invoke something under the same conditions, does it always return the same thing? So it's easier perhaps to think about functions, right? If you think about the first line, pure or impure language or function or method, right? So if you have a pure function, let's say, I mean, if you think about a function in mathematics, right? Like, let's maybe draw this again. Like, if you have a function that's called f, and it takes some x, and it's implemented as x times 2, right? Or 2x, I should have written, whatever. So that means, of course, that if you have f of 5, then you will have 10. If you have f of 10, you will have 20, right? Now the question is this function pure or not? This is, of course, pure, right? This is a pure function. It always returns the same thing under similar conditions. But, and I shouldn't maybe say under similar conditions, it always returns the same thing given the same input. That's the thing, right? But here's the thing, if you're in an imperative language, then these would be statements, and you would execute first this statement, then the next one, then the next one. What happens if suddenly I execute f of 5 and I get back 100, let's say, right? And I'm like, what? I ran f on 5 and I got 10, and now I run f on 5 and I get 100. Like, what is this strange f that sort of sometimes computes the double and sometimes computes something entirely different, right? And the problem here is external state. So it might be that f, let's say the implementation of f isn't actually this, right? Let's say the implementation of f is to read whatever value you are giving it, you are passing it as an argument, but also maybe something like, let's say, whatever values you've stored in it already, or something like it reads something from disk, let's say, right? Like it reads from your actual computer and it looks at a file or something like this, right? So, okay, let's maybe say it like this. If we only think about functions, and if you think about this notion, I didn't put that on the slide, but I should perhaps have put that on the slide. Referential transparency, right? Sorry about the crappy writing. So referential transparency. So if you have this notion of referential transparency, or if you have this property of referential transparency, if a function has that, then that means that the function can be memoized. That means that you can tabularize the function. So if you think about doubling, for example, you can tabularize it, right? Because you can say, if I pass 2, then I will always get back 4. If I pass 3, I will always get back 6. If I pass 4, I will always get back 8. And so forth, right? Unfortunately, this particular function is, of course, infinitely long. Like, the tabular table is infinitely long. So when we say it can be tabularized, that means it can be tabularized in theory, right? Not necessarily in practice, because you couldn't do this in practice because you would run out of memory in the computer. But if you have something like a Boolean, right? This would be input and this would be output of the function. But if you have something like a Boolean, then you of course only have two input values. You have either true or you have false, let's say. I mean, what would the other things be? There's nothing, right? There's nothing to put here, because you can only have true as input or false as input, because the set Boolean, right? The set Boolean contains only true and only false. Those are the only two valid options in these set of Booleans. So, and I don't know what this function would be. Maybe it would be something that converts a Boolean to an integer, so converts it to a numeric representation. So maybe true would be 1, false would be 0, right? So this would be the output. So this is the notion of referential transparency or purity, right? So if a function is pure, that means it always returns the same value. And if it's impure, that means it doesn't do that, right? And what are reasons for being impure, right? Reasons for that could be randomness. You use pseudo-random numbers, right? Because all random numbers in computers are pseudo-random. Or it could be that you interact with externalities, such as, for example, the file system, the internet, or the user, or something like this. It depends on outside state that isn't contained in the function that you have. And now I say function, but of course that goes for method as well. And I put language here because if your language demands purity, right? If it demands that everything is pure, such as, for example, Haskell, roughly, then we say that the language is pure. But you can also talk about just a pure function or a pure method. Now, notice I think I used the terms side effect, right? So when we say that something is impure, that means it must have side effects. Sorry, maybe not must have. It depends on external state or it has side effects. So for example, if it's something that writes to disk, then writing to disk is a side effect. Sorry, I say disk, but I mean, we don't have disks anymore. We have flash storage in computers. But I mean, you get what I mean when I say write to disk. When it persists something in the computer or it sends something off to the internet, that's a side effect. It sends an email or it posts something to Instagram. Sorry, for, I don't know why I keep coming back to Instagram. I don't even use Instagram. So if it has side effects, then that's impure, right? And the side effect is this thing that it does that's changing the state of the universe, let's say, right? If you think of the whole universe, the state of the whole universe, if you just have a function that doubles numbers, right? It doesn't change the universe. But if you have a function that doubles numbers and saves that number to file, then it actually changes the universe, right? Changes the state of the program. So the opposite of side effect free would be effectful, or that it has a side effect. And then we have this just so that you get the terminology, right? Because I'm trying to emphasize the importance of terminology in this lecture series. Immutable and mutable are basically the same things. Immutable means pure, and mutable means that it is impure, it has effects. And those are terms that we usually use in terms of types. So if you're constructing a type, let's say if you have the list type in C#, for example, then the list type is impure, right? It is a mutable implementation of lists. Why? Because if you have a list, let's say x equals 1, 2, 3, right? Let's think about arrays or lists or whatever. I mean, I use the term list loosely, right? If you have a list and it contains these numbers, and then you say x.push, for example, so that means add, right? Maybe I should say add because it's more clear. You say x.add, and I want to add the number 4. That means x now actually contains 1, 2, 3, 4. So I've changed the contents of x. Like here, at this, if you think about this as time progresses downwards, right? It's like time is progressing in this axis, right? First we execute this statement, then we execute this statement, then we execute this statement. Here, x contains 1, 2, 3, right? Here, it still contains 1, 2, 3 when we enter this line. Sorry, this was when we exited this line, right? So when we exit this line, x contains 1, 2, 3. And when we exit the second line, x actually contains 1, 2, 3, 4. Right? So yeah, I mean, here I wrote x equals 1, 2, 3, 4. This is redundant, right? Because we've added in 4. But I guess I should say equals equals or something like this. But the point is, a mutable list actually changes the contents of the variable. And this is very, very important, because this means that anyone who has a reference, right? Think about reference types. Anyone who talks about this x, right? Anyone who has a reference, who knows about this x, they will all now have a new list, even though they didn't do anything. Sorry, not a new list. They will have the same list, but that same list now contains 1, 2, 3, 4, not 1, 2, 3, because that list has changed under them without them actually doing anything, right? And this, you can probably from this start to get a feeling of why people get so upset about mutability and like have said things such as mutability is the root of all evil, or impurity is the root of all evil. Because when things change without you being involved in that change, in very, very large programs, this can be very, I was going to say stressful, which it could be, I guess, if you're debugging it. Debugging means trying to find bugs, trying to find the problems in code in order to try to get rid or to fix errors in code, right? That's debugging, to get rid of the bugs. And there's some apocryphal stories about how debugging was actually a term coined because they found bugs, like literal bugs in big machines when computers were like room sized, but I don't know how true that is. But anyways, so what was I going to say? It can be very stressful debugging programs that contain mutability, right? If a program mutates, then it can be very difficult to find who actually changed the contents of something. And it can be very difficult to reason about your program if you all the time have to expect that things can change even though you didn't change them. So when you're designing data types, right? When you are designing your sets, you should think about immutability and mutability. You should think, is this something that changes its state, or is this something that doesn't change its state? And that impacts how other people should use, other parts of your code should use that particular type, should interact with that particular type. Okay, let's drop this. Okay, so summary. I just want to say quickly that what we've talked about today is essentially the question of what a programming language is. And we've talked about this question in relation to a number of different questions, that you can ask yourself when you're looking at a programming language. What is code, right? It depends on a bunch of different things, but mostly it depends on the paradigm. Right? Is it, for example, imperative or declarative? Because you have different modes of thinking about programming. But then you have all these other aspects, such as compiled or interpreted, statically typed or dynamically typed, pure or impure. We talked about reference types and value types. Like, there are all these specifics that make languages slightly different. But at its core, the main question is sort of what paradigm are you operating in? So, okay, if you survived this long into this video, kudos to you. I hope you're learning a lot. Leave me something in the comments so we can have something to talk about. Smash the like button. I'll see you in the next lecture.